Welcome in to Outkick the Show. I'm your fearless leader, Clay Travis. I hope all of you are having fantastic Tuesdays, wherever you may be. If you are in a Super Tuesday state, do what I did. Go vote. I'm going to vote as soon as I finish this show today. Well, actually, I got Fox News with Martha McCollum. Then I'm going to go head out, get my vote, make my voice heard. I'll tell you who I'm voting for so that I always do. This is not something new. During the course of the show, I'll go ahead and tell you right off the top, I'm voting for Donald Trump in the Tennessee primary. I believe Donald Trump should be the nominee. I'm going to vote for Donald Trump in the 2024 presidential election. I've always told you who I vote for in my entire career because I think it's important to be as honest with your audience as you can be. So I'm voting for Trump over Nikki Haley in the 2024 Tennessee Republican primary. I'm going to vote for Donald Trump over Joe Biden or whomever ends up the Democrat nominee if they force out Joe Biden. I'm going to be voting for Trump. So that's out there. Run with it if you will. Got a lot to talk about here. I'm going to talk about Stephen A. Smith. He came at me on his podcast, his YouTube show podcast, going after my opinions on DEI. I'm going to double, triple, quadruple down. I think I'm right. I'll explain why. Charles Barkley says he would punch a black guy, if he saw him wearing the Trump arrest T-shirt. I like Charles. I think it was a stupid comment. CNN ran with it. I'm going to talk about it. Mark Cuban says he's going to endorses Joe Biden, says he's going to vote for him no matter what. Mark Cuban, sad reflection, what he's become. I'll talk about it. Fannie Willis, Nathan Wade, where are we going there? I told you yesterday I would discuss it. Caitlin Clark and Iowa women's basketball dunks all over the NBA ratings. We will talk about that. Russell Wilson out in Denver, one of the worst trades in the history of the NFL. I'll break all that down for you. All that still to come. Again, I encourage all of you to go vote. It's Super Tuesday, regardless of what your political positions are. Make sure you take the time to get out and vote up and down the ballot. All right. Want to hit you with my reaction. Stephen A. Smith did a show yesterday where he reacted to me saying that my position on diversity, equity, and inclusion in which I endorsed Ron DeSantis and the state of Florida firing everyone who was taxpayer-funded DEI employees at the University of Florida and other state institutions, that I agree with it. I don't know. I think we have an audio. We haven't done this before. Are we going to try to play Stephen A. on his show and allow some of you to see it if you have not? And then I will respond to it. You guys can text me if we're going to try that. I know there was some discussion that we're going to try. We've never worked live video in before, so I don't know if we're going to do it. I think we are. So here is Stephen A. on his show. I'm going to give you a little bit of a snippet of him talking about my opinion, and then I will expound upon it. Here it is.
You're a lawyer. By profession, by study, that's what you study. You came on this show and talked about how you were in the Virgin Islands practicing law before ultimately you made transitions into this field. You sold Outkick. You got different business opportunities coming up. Man, I ain't got no problems with that. All for it. God bless you. But if you're going to bring up the subject, tell a story. When you want the eradication and the elimination of DEI, why is that? Is it the dissipation of the white populace in the country? Is it the open borders that have more migrants coming into this country? Is it the fact that the white population is dissipating while other populations are growing? And you have some folks in white society that are incredibly worried about their quote unquote position that they've enjoyed for so much, for so long? Is it all of those things? If it is, say so. If we're going to talk about it, talk about it. If you're scared, say you're scared. Say it.
All right, that's Stephen A. You guys, hopefully that worked and you were able to hear it. I think that you were, and I'm going to now kind of dive in here, okay? So one of the, and I've watched some of the clips. Candidly, I haven't watched the whole thing because I haven't had time. I got a kid with strep throat, so we kind of been a little bit off the reservation here compared to normal. But let me just kind of dive into this in general. So I'm going to give you a little bit of history as well because you guys know that I am a super history nerd. Diversity, equity, and inclusion, in my opinion, as it is applied today, is actually foundational racism. And I'm going to break down each of these words and explain why. And then I'll talk about the history of how it's come to be. Diversity. To me, the only thing that matters when we talk about diversity is diversity of thought. There is not one single employee that I am aware of at all of ESPN that has come out and told you that they are voting for Donald Trump. Not one. I just told you I'm voting for Donald Trump. People have the right to vote for Donald Trump, Joe Biden, RFK Jr. You can vote for the Green Party candidate. You can vote for Cornel West. You can vote for whoever you would like. What does it say about the intellectual environment and freedom of thought at ESPN that not one single employee has come out publicly and said, I'm voting for Donald Trump? Compare that to the number that will come out and proudly say they voted for Obama, or they voted for Hillary Clinton, or they're voting for Joe Biden. I think that's significant. The only diversity that should matter is diversity of thought. I don't care if we have a bunch of people of different colors that all have the exact same thought. The only reason why diversity is a strength is because of the First Amendment, conflict of ideas. University campuses are overrun by Democrat voters. It's hard to find a Republican voter in a position of prominence inside of most university history departments, English departments, political science departments. They almost don't exist. Law schools. Actual conservatives employed at law schools almost don't exist. Again, the only diversity I care about is diversity of thought. Focusing on diversity of color as if that is somehow a strength doesn't make any sense. Cosmetic diversity is not diversity at all. Why does it matter if everybody looks different but thinks the same? That ain't diversity. So I'm opposed to everything except diversity of thought, which is the only diversity that matters. Equity. Equity is BS. I believe in equality of opportunity. I believe that the United States should treat all people, white, black, Asian, Hispanic, gay, straight, male, female, the same under the law. There is a reason why Lady Justice is blind. Equity doesn't do that. Equity tries to give artificial versions of success based on what we think society should look like. Equity is the opposite of everything that Stephen A. does, is talk about sports. We don't want equity in sports. We want inequality. Somebody is trying to be better than someone else. We don't want everybody to be even. We don't want to start a sporting event where one team gets 10 extra points because of where they're from or what their daddy or their mommy did. Everybody should be equal, but the outcome should not be equity. It should be equality of opportunity, not the government reaching in and saying, oh, we're going to make this percentage employed this amount. No, I am opposed to equity with every fiber of my being. And remember, this is important. They changed equality and started talking about equity, thinking that nobody was going to notice because equality didn't give them the outcome that they wanted. Okay? I'm opposed to equity. I'm not necessarily opposed to inclusion, but this is what capitalism does. If you have a market, you win. If you serve a market, like Stephen A. does, First Take is the highest rated show in its time slot. He deserves to be compensated for that. He's not equal to Skip Bayless. He crushes Skip Bayless. If Skip Bayless crushed him, Skip Bayless would deserve to get paid. The person who does the best serving their audience, whether it's McDonald's or Burger King, whether it's Stephen A. Smith or Skip Bayless, deserves to be rewarded. Capitalism, by its nature, is inclusive because markets demand that all be served. Now, then Stephen A. went into this discussion. I think he had Michael Eric Dyson on, who basically just believes that America is an awful place, and he would argue that all of us should have to pay trillions of dollars in reparations. I'm a believer that you should be judged. This might be radical. Not by what somebody did before you, but by what you yourself do. I could not vote for president of the United States until the 21st century. In 2000, I've been public about my voting. In 2000, I voted for Al Gore. In 2004, I voted for John Kerry. 2008, I voted for Barack Obama. 2012, I voted for Barack Obama. 2016, I voted Gary Johnson. 2020, I voted Trump. 2024, I'm going to vote Trump. That's all my presidential elections. I was born in 1979. I went to integrated public schools in Nashville, Tennessee, K through 12. I went to a high school named after Martin Luther King Jr., MLK. I was the president of the student body when I graduated in 1997, okay? I don't believe that anybody who grew up and is around my age, that they have dealt with any crazy amount of racism that demands that we reach in and alter the outcome of business. That is, if you were born like I was around 1980, and you went to public school like I did, starting in around 1985 in Nashville, Tennessee, I don't think you were treated any different if you were white, black, Asian, or Hispanic. I graduated from a school named after MLK. Our principal was a black woman. I had tons of black teachers. I had tons of black classmates, not really any Hispanic classmates at the time. I don't know what the public schools would look like in Nashville now, but we didn't have a huge Hispanic population. A lot of Asian kids at my school. I think everybody was treated the exact same. I really do. And I think I would have had the exact same measure of success if I were black, Asian, Hispanic, or white. I believe that America historically has had all sorts of issues of racism. By the time I went to school, I think we have more issues of fake racism in America today than we do actual racism. And I think if you were raised in the 90s like I was, and if you were raised in the early 2000s like I was, I think that we have gone backwards in race relations since those days because of the principles of DEI. Now, if you are 70 or 80 years old and you are watching me right now, or you are older and you grew up in a Jim Crow era, you grew up in a pre-civil rights America, your experience is totally different than mine. And I don't begrudge the decisions that were made to address those clear wrongs. But at some point, you move from trying to address wrongs to embracing racism, but trying to argue that it favors others. This is why I'm opposed to reparations. This is why I'm opposed to affirmative action. This is why I'm opposed to diversity and equity in the name of race. I think it's entirely wrong. I saw Michael Eric Dyson try to say, Michael Jordan wouldn't have existed without DEI. What is he talking about? Look, Michael Jordan and every other black athlete, I didn't grow up in a Jackie Robinson era. I grew up with black athlete posters on my wall. I had Bo Jackson with the pads and the baseball bat. I had Jordan dunking from the free throw line. I had Eric Davis, big Reds fan. Barry Larkin. My era did not grow up where athletes were treated unequally. Oprah Winfrey was the most watched Daily Show host. Michael Jordan was the wealthiest of all athletes. Tiger Woods made more money than anybody, whatever race you want to attribute, Kablan Asian, to Tiger Woods. And this whole argument, Barack Obama, I voted for twice. Go back and look at Barack Obama's 2008 presidential campaign. A lot of what he said in 2008 would make him a Republican today. I believe we have gone backward. I think DEI, I think that the identity politics focus of the Democrat Party has actually taken us backwards. I've written a lot about this, not only in my last book, but in the current book. And so I'm happy to debate Stephen A. Smith anywhere. I don't think he's successful because he's black. I think he's successful because he's talented, which is how the meritocracy should work. There are other black guys that got great opportunities at ESPN. I think Bomani Jones is a good example. Dude failed in radio, failed in TV, failed in premium TV, has never been able to create an audience, keeps getting promoted because he's a black guy. That's DEI. People think, oh, Bomani Jones deserves to be promoted because he looks like what they want somebody in that position to look like, and audiences overwhelmingly reject him everywhere, yet he keeps getting promoted. DEI is the opposite of meritocracy. It's the opposite of sports. And so I'm ready to debate this anytime, any place, anywhere. DEI is the antithesis of everything that sports represents. The best man should win. In fact, if you actually want to apply DEI, you're going to have to fire a bunch of black dudes. Because guess what? The basketball team that represents the United States is all black. The best players in the country are black. But if we wanted the DEI basketball team to perfectly represent racial difference in America, you'd have to fire a bunch of black dudes. Only 12 or 13% of that team would be black. About 10 black guys got to get fired. That doesn't make any sense. Best man or best woman should get the job. Best man or best woman should win the championship. I think that Stephen A. Smith has been misled about what DEI actually is. You can be a student of history like I am, acknowledge that America has many sins in its past, as all countries do, and believe that the way to solve things going forward is not with DEI or even any government involvement anymore. Because here's the truth. You go look at the data. Read Thomas Sowell. The black family has collapsed since Lyndon Johnson created the Great Society in the 1960s. Men and women married and had children in families at a, I think, 70% clip in 1960 in America. The legacy of slavery still existed in 1960 way more, in fact, than it does today. And yet, black Americans overwhelmingly were being raised in a two-parent household. Since the Great Society, the black family has been destroyed such that I believe the data is now only about 25% of black kids grow up with a mom and a dad in the household. Why is that? I think it's because of policies like DEI that actually claim to help when in reality they push down overall success. So I believe we should have no state-funded DEI policies anywhere in America. I believe that race-conscious admission should not exist in colleges and universities. I don't think you should get judged on a different standard based on the color of your skin. I think that is racist. And I think it actually pushes black people down, as well as Hispanic people and Asian people and white people, because it divides us instead of bringing us together. I am old school in this way. I believe all of us have way more in common, white, black, Asian, Hispanic, than we do different. And I think the politics of America today tries to tell us that's not true by using race as a proxy to divide us. And I think ultimately, and this is fascinating, and I write a lot about it in my book, the unfortunate legacy of Barack Obama's election was that Democrats believed that identity politics was the only way that they could end up replicating Obama's coalition. Guess what? People are not responding to that favorably because black voters are moving to the Republican Party. Hispanic voters are moving to the Republican Party. Asian voters are moving to the Republican Party. Trump is going to get more minority voters potentially than any Republican presidential candidate ever. Why is that? Because a lot of people, white, black, Asian, and Hispanic, know that identity politics and this DEI universe is broken, and it is the opposite of the American meritocracy, and we should be summarily rejecting it. But again, I'll have a debate about this, and I'll go anywhere, anytime, any place, anywhere. I will show up and put DEI on trial and argue that it is the absence of everything that we should be striving for in American society. I want everybody to be elite. I want everybody to be successful. And I think, honestly, I like Charles Barkley. I think this was a misguided comment that he made on CNN when he said that if he saw somebody in a Trump mugshot t-shirt, he would attack him. Now, I think he was making a joke. But the reality is this. America cannot survive as a thriving country if identity politics remains the law of the land. I'm a white guy. If you see me walking down the street, you have no idea how I'm going to vote. You may know me because I just told you I was going to vote for Trump. But if you see a bearded white guy, brown hair, 44 years old like me, you have really no idea how I'm going to be voting for president when I go into the ballot. Black guys, black women, overwhelmingly vote Democrat. I just laid out the data since the 1960s. How has that helped you? Honestly. The family has collapsed. Crazy stat for you. Men see it. You know that men have not voted for a Democrat since 1964? Lyndon Johnson was the last Democrat politician that men voted for. Everyone since then has been rejected. Women put Democrats into the White House. Why are men overwhelmingly rejecting it? I think a lot of black men are going to show up and vote for Donald Trump in 2024 because they see it and they feel it and they recognize that they've been sold a bill of goods like Hispanic guys do and like Asian guys do. They're not saying Trump's perfect. They're just saying Biden is weak and ineffectual and he is selling a bill of goods. So I would love to debate this. I think history matters. And I think evolving from history matters. I can't and shouldn't be responsible for anything somebody did in the 1800s or anything people did in the 1700s or anything people did in the 1000s. I can only be responsible for the things that I do. And since I have voted in America in the 21st century, 2000, first time I could ever vote, I think America is going backwards on race, and I think DEI is why. And if you want to argue about the legacy of Jim Crow, I think that the left is now full on in favor of racism. And I think the left has more in common today with the Jim Crow era than the right does. And I'll debate that anywhere. All right, I went on long here. I may need to roll a lot of these other stories over because I've got to go do television right now. I'll talk about Russell Wilson tomorrow. I'll talk about Caitlin Clark tomorrow, Fannie Willis, Nathan Wade, Mark Cuban. Let me finish with the comments from Charles Barkley. Charles Barkley's a free thinker. I like him. I've been out to dinner with him a lot. I've interviewed him a lot. I think he's hopelessly wrong in the way that he's analyzing black Trump voters. And as a free thinker, who I think in the past has identified as a Republican, I would encourage Charles Barkley to think about why I believe up to a quarter of black men may be voting for Donald Trump in this election. And I don't always think that Trump is the most articulate arguer for why that is occurring, but I think it's because they're recognizing, as many men are and women all over the country, that they're being told profound lies and that there is truth in America. And that the truth is this, every child, you want to talk about privilege, the best privilege you can give to any child is to have a dad and a mom in the house every day with that kid. I've got three boys, 16, 13, and 9. I will be in the house with them until they are off to college. I'm not saying I'm a perfect dad. Like every mom and dad out there, I've got flaws. But I was incredibly fortunate to have a mom and dad in my house. That is the biggest, most consistent privilege that I had. And my kids are going to have a mom and dad in their house, God willing, until they head off to college and are full-grown adults. I'll have one in college in 2 years, basically. And that, I think, is what people are coming around on and recognizing, that all this anti-masculine talk, all this talk of toxic masculinity, all of it cancel culture, the left is destroying America today. And I think many of you feel it. And I'll debate this with Stephen A. I'll debate this with Charles Barkley. I'll debate this with anybody out there with a substantial audience that can articulate why they are in favor of DEI or think that black Trump supporters should be punched. I think we're at an incredibly important pivot point in America where identity politics is going to be destroyed once and for all. And I am excited to see that happen because I think that will allow us to all step, white, black, Asian, Hispanic, into a better version of the future. All right, there's my response. I'll talk more about these other issues tomorrow. I got to go do Fox News. Then I got to go vote. If you are in one of the 15 states or American Samoa and you're watching me right now, I would encourage you, get out and vote. Take advantage of your franchise. Go up and down the ballot. Vote for the people that you think will best represent your views and help to advance the country into a better tomorrow. DBAP, unless you need to SBAP, I am Clay Travis. This has been Outkick, the show.